So, good afternoon. At the outset, I would like to thank the Dr.Metha Hospital authorities for having me here. And I'm also privileged to speak about the diet in cancer prevention. And I also welcome and also thank the other dignitaries, especially firstly Dr. Ramaling, then Dr.K.Ramaling, and Dr. Kamla. So before going into the main topic, diet and cancer prevention, so I would like to give so I was working as a professor in training at Women's Arts College. Then I joined after my retirement as a senior scientist in Unicron Biotech. And I think Unicron Biotech is involved in the blood group antibody preparations. And there I worked for 4 years in some projects, and we did some research on rabies as well as the snake venom antibody preparations. Then I joined Harvard University in biotech department as a federal department, and I served there for 2 years. After that, I am a professor and institutional ethics committee member in the Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Hospital. So, in the Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Hospital, I have been there since 2007, and I'm still continuing as a committee member. And my duty is only to sign that every month they will call for the meeting, and the cancer specialist also will be there along with others like the lawyers and psychiatrists. I am one among them as biochemical expert. So, with regard to diet in cancer, I would like to emphasize more on the breast cancer and prostate cancer, because both of them are hormone responsive solid tumors. So in that, before going into the real strategies of the nutrition or the phytochemical nutrients, I would like to give an outline and glimpse about the various definitions of the cancer and how these definitions from foreign authors are conforming to what we have found out in research. So the cancer definition, it was nicely given by Newland. Everybody thinks of life only, but this author has written a book, How We Die. So in that book, he has written that cancer far from clandestine foe, in fact, berserk with the malicious exuberance of killing. The disease pursues a continuous and uninhibited circumferential bomb-burning expedition of destructiveness, in which it heeds no rules, follows no commands, and explores all resistance in a homicidal riot of devastation. Its cells behave like the members of barbarian horde, run amok, leaderless and undirected, but with a single purpose in mind: to plunder everything within reach. Then the next definition is also very interesting, given by Matlin. So, stealthy as a pirate slipping from a cove, the cancer cell severs the moorings that attach it to the surrounding tissue. Slowly, it extends 1, 2, or 3 finger-like probes and begins to creep. Then it detects the pulsating presence of a nearby capillary and darts between the cells that compose the blood vessel wall. It dives into the red river that courses through the lung, liver, breast, and brain. An hour or so later, surfaces on some tranquil shore and settles down. It tricks nearby cells into forming foot-bearing blood vessels, then compels them to churn out growth-spurring chemicals to shield itself from the battling immune cells of the host or the patient. The cancer cell sprouts spiny armor like a sea urchin to expel the agents sent to kill it. the cancer cell deploys around its membrane a bag of tiny pumps. Is there a way to fight such a foe? So these two definitions taught me very much. And I used to address the students sometimes with the Tamil psalm also written by Kannadasa. So as far as the disease cancer is concerned, Kannadasan has written one lyric. It was in an old film, and Sivaji Ganesan has acted for that. Elumukkum sarakkum maruthuvam kandeen, edharukkum marunde kandeen. So likewise, still cancer has become a problem, unsolved problem. And still doubt remains whether the chemotherapy works 100% and whether the prevention strategy is also 100%. It is a questionable one. So, the foreign books have written how the prevention is also an equally important strategy and equivalent to the treatment modalities like surgery or radiation treatment or the chemotherapy treatment or the immunotherapy or recently the monoclonal antibodies treatment. So the field of oncology has been engaging relentlessly in advancing the cancer therapeutic research and thinking of prevention strategies. In his own words, Weiler says it was indubitably true that prevention as a strategy had been neglected by the National Cancer Institute USA. He also found 1960s and 70s did not witness so much a difficult birth of approaches to prevention that focused on environmental and lifestyle causes of cancer. So these are the two main aspects which are attributed as the causative agents or the causative factors for the cancer. So Harold Manner, in his book, also written a few sentences that is also eye-catching. There is an urgent need to go back or get back to the basics, back to nature and back to health. We must not expect anyone to do this for us. We must educate and inform ourselves until a good nutrition and a proper lifestyle makes sense to us and become part of us. We must use our heads to protect our bodies. We must prevent disease to preserve mankind. So regarding the cancer disease, there are three main determinants. Number one, the various risk factors, among which some of them are prognostic factors, have been established. And the other one is a pro-carcinogens exposure in the environment. And the third one is the carcinogens exposure. So regarding the risk factors, now everybody knows that what are the risk factors, both the intrinsic and the extrinsic, or endogenous and exogenous factors, which may become a cause for the induction of cancer cells, or the genome will be altered, and as a result, a normal cell can be transformed into a cancer cell. And likewise, the co-carcinogens exposure in the environment is also there. So these co-carcinogens are nothing but the chemical compounds or the substances. When they get into the system of our body, they are getting metabolized. As a result, they become the carcinogens. They become the active substances or the active carcinogens. As a result, they will immediately transform the carcinogenic process and by means of the mutations. So one researcher has given a report that before the cancer cell pronounces or it manifests itself outwardly, it has been accumulating 1 lakh mutations. So it is not a single mutation. It is not that the proto-oncogenes mutations or the tumor suppressor mutations are responsible for the cancer origin. Many downline genes and even the mitochondrial genes. So the nuclear genome and mitochondrial genome has got a little subtle difference. The nuclear genome is endowed with the repairing mechanism, whereas the mitochondrial genes endowed with some thousands and thousands of genes are the base pairs. They are not irreparable, because the repairing enzymes are completely absent. One of my students worked in breast cancer. He has reported 900 mutations in the D-loop region of the mitochondria, as well as in the Y chromosome of the cells. So it is only the mutations but we call it as a single nucleotide polymorphisms or single nucleotide variations. When they go on accumulating at one particular instance or minute, they transform the cell. The normal cell will be transformed into a malignant cell and they become internal terrorist. The malignant cell, if the regulating factors are absent inside the body, that is, if the patient or if the individual is not competent, immunologically competent. So, I even just published last month one paper whether the immunosuppression is an after effect of cancer or it is a precedent, antecedent effect of effect before the cancer manifestation. So, I said that the cancer comes to all susceptible people who are immunologically nude or immunologically completely incompetent. How that incompetency comes means it is right from your birth. Right from your birth, from the vertical transmission, that is your pro-carcinogens, even your dioxins and polychlorinated biphenyl compounds, polychlorinated compounds, all these compounds can pass through the placental barrier. And so the neonates are liable to get the effect of these carcinogens, pro-carcinogenic stimuli. As I said, right from childhood, we are going on stressed, we are going on immunologically fighting with the existing cells, and some of the genes are inhibiting the transformation. That we call it as humans, the suppressor genes or the tumor suppressor genes, and some of the genes remain as silent, they are there, which we refer as proto-oncogenes. In addition to this, the downline genes we have noticed, these mutations are also responsible for bringing the transformation of tumorigenesis or the carcinogenesis process. So, like the three factors, we can attack the cancers through these three profiles. One is a metabolic profile, another one is a genomic profile, another one is a proteomic profile. And similarly, the cancer cells are also employing the three strategies. One is a metabolic strategy, another one is a genomic strategy, another one is a proteomic strategy. So you know that in our body, about 60,000 proteins are being produced. So through the Human Genome Project, we come to know now that 30,000 genes are now able to produce about 60,000 proteins, and some of them are very vital in life-saving saving the life. At the same time, they are also responsible for disease alleviation. And similarly, the cancer cells are also very tricky, and they also alter the metabolism. Their metabolism is unlike the normal cells, they will be different. So they will be, their respiration will be different from normal cells. You know already that the warp burst effect. So the metabolic functioning of the cancer cells are different from that of the normal cells. That is, they undergo the hypoxic anaerobic respiration or glycolysis. As a result, they produce the lactic acid. So I said what are the criteria by which, by the nutrition, you can control or prevent the cancer induction. One is the glucose. So when I talked to some people, some doctors even say that you can take anything. In the cancer period, they advise the patients you can take anything as the food. But now, having gone through the research papers, I have come to the conclusion that glucose is the first enemy to the cancer patient and the best friend to the cancer cells, because the cancer cells have got different mechanisms to utilize the glucose, and if the glucose is unavailable, they can even utilize the pentose phosphate pathway. And even if it is not available, they have now, it has been reported in Devita et al., Devita book, that is an oncology book, that cancer cells do the same process of polycycle. So it usually in mammals, the polycycle operates in liver cells, where the lactic acid is converted to glucose. How come these cancer cells have got that, acquired the property of conversion of lactate to glucose? I don't know. So the lactic acid accumulation becomes a micro niche around the cancer cell or tumor cell mass. So if you control this lactic acid, if you don't control, then the acidic environment will go on promoting the proliferation of the cancer cells. That is another point in nutrition. So what are the multiple risk factors? So it is already known to all the medical medicos. There is consumption of tobacco and tobacco products. Even yesterday I heard in the YouTube on gentleman talking about the tobacco smoke. So it contains about I don't know whether it is an exaggeration or not. It has got about 7,000 chemical compounds. But so far in literature we have noticed that theophylline, theobromine and nicotine are the co-carcinogenic compounds present in the smoke. And the active smokers, what is the difference between an active smoker and a passive smoker? He said that more than the active smoker, the passive smokers are much affected, because the passive smoker is inhaling all the smokes liberated or coming out from the primary smoker. So passive smokers are more dangerous, are more succumbing to the cancer probability than the active smokers. And next one, alcohol. That also, he said alcohol is for social drinking it's okay, but if it becomes a regular habit, but the Indian context, you can see some people are waiting before the cosmetic shop is opening. They will do all assistance to the authorities of the shop, and they will put the key and they will open, they will put all the clear the space, all these things they will do. They are all the addicts. So when alcohol becomes an addict, then you cannot help them. So they are very much liable to liver cancer. Likewise, bacterial infections is also one thing. Everybody knows that. So the best example is the pylori bacterium, Helicobacter pylori. So it was first reported as an endocommensal bacteria, just like your E. coli. But now, in the WHO in 1974, has reported that the Helicobacter pylori is a carcinogen. So it can induce initially the star ulcers, and later on it will end up in cancer also. Likewise, the other bacterial infections, you know that, and even in 1960s, one paper I have seen, the Staphylococcus and Salmonella infections have given rise to Hodgkin's lymphoma, blood leukemia, and other liver cancers, etc. So the infections, bacterial infections is continuous bacterial infections. Next one is a viral infections. Everybody know that HPV is responsible for bringing the cervical cancer, human papillomavirus, and that is why the pap smear test has become mandatory nowadays after the girl has attained 30 years. In states and all, they do every 2 years the pap smear test. So the papillomavirus only identified that this virus is responsible for making the hyperplastic or hyperplasia condition of the cervical regions. And one of my students, Dr. Indra, she went for Taiwan for a project on a parasite. She worked in this trichomanos vaginalis. So I asked what significance you have taken an insignificant parasite that it lives in the vaginal canals. She only told me that, so sir, don't say like that. That will prepare a ground for the further infections of even the HIV, and also for the further transformation of the cells into cervical cancer. That much she has worked with point mutations of the trichomonas vaginalis. And deprivation and deficiency of antioxidants in the body. Nowadays everybody knows, and every shop, the label contains it is an antioxidant, vitamin B3. Even if you take oil, they will put vitamin E plus D3 fortified oil like that. So if antioxidants are deficient, also it will be a risk factor. Then another one is a synthesis of free radicals. So we thought that other scientific people will be thinking that the free radicals are nothing but the cancer people only will be getting. No. Even in a normal cell, the mitochondria spontaneously release these free radicals. And these free radicals are able to affect the cells, cellular genome, cellular proteins, etc. Next one is a carcinogenic chemicals. Then regarding the infections, I have left this parasitic infections. So in the parasitic infections only, the trichomonas vaginalis is one. Another one is cystosomiasis. Luckily in India, we don't have the cystosoma infection. Cystosoma hematobium is one which is causing the bladder cancer as well as other surrounding tissues. And when whenever I give some talk about the parasitic aspects, I use it to tell to my students, cystosoma hematobium is a very much very important parasite, and it has got a, whenever it lays the eggs in the urinary bladder, the hematobium will have a hook, and this hook will punch the muscular walls of the urinary bladder. As a result, the urine becomes bloody red. So whenever the African men or the people, men, it is only affecting the afflicting the men. Whenever the African man is urinating, he will bloody urine will be coming out. This is why it is nicknamed as menstruating men's disease. Then next one is exposure to radiation. So that is also again a probability or possibility, because excess exposure to solar rays also is dangerous, because UV radiation can cause the mutations. And likewise, you don't know, we don't know that how far these radons. So the radons are also creeping in our houses from the crevices of the floorings. So we thought that the floorings, when we put it in vinyl chloride or any other tiles, it is very safe. It is not so. So the radons are also radiations which can induce the cancers. And the other one is a stress. So this is, everybody is now talking. Stress is an important factor for all the diseases. For all the diseases, the stress is an important factor. And that too in the cancer, it causes. Because the stress proteins will be liberated. You know already what is a heat shock protein 90, heat shock protein 70 and all. And the implications of heat shock proteins in cancer is also very important. And the lack of parasitic, it is very much for the Indians only, because everybody is cautious about the parents with that. But in India, half of the population will be still reeling under the poverty line, and they are not taking the parents with that. And so some parents diet lacking is also attributed as one reason. Another one is a deficiency of vitamins and minerals. So in fact, the lay people may not be knowing what are the roles of the vitamins do or the minerals. Now we are telling that selenium is an important mineral. So for cancer prevention, selenium 200 microgram per day is essential for preventing the cancer. Likewise, the zinc of which has come out now in market. Zinc is also a very essential element. Likewise, the magnesium that is present in mushrooms. So the magnesium is also an important mineral. And you know the role of copper in lymphoma. So copper is essential for preventing the lymphoma cancer. So the diet should contain all the essential minerals or the vitamins. If not, it should be supplemented. It should be supplemented as tablets. Then one of my students did epidemiology. One of my students did epidemiology in different cancers. One in cervical cancer, another one in colorectal cancer, another one in breast. And in that, the colorectal cancer patient, the student, has watched in one particular village, as well as he has surveyed Tirunelveli district, Madras district, and some Nagarkoil districts. These people are accustomed to more carbonated waters. So, if you take soda, the sound comes fish, like that, the cook also come out with a fish sound. They thought that it is a very healthy drink, not so. So, if you take once in a while, these carbonated drinks, especially the Coke and Coca-Cola and all these things, if it becomes a habituation, then it will end up in colorectal cancer only. So that we have put it in the structural part diagram. Some combination of factors will be resulting in cancers. So the colorectal cancers, we have some combination of factors. In that, the one important factor is the carbonated water drinking, which has become a routine affair of certain people who are involved in business. So next one is sexual promiscuity. Already you know that how this HIV, HPV, and then the herpes simplex, HSV, all these things are transmitted through the sexual promiscuity. And comorbid conditions, the continuous fever, continuous cough, how these comorbid conditions can also promote the cancers. Then sleeplessness. So it should come only when we get old. So only aging people will complain about the insomnia or the sleepless condition. But when it goes to youngsters, if they don't have minimum 7 hours sleep, that is also becoming a factor. Then lack of natural immunity. So nowadays I used to say that lactation is very essential for the neonates, for the children. Lactation will bring so much of immunity, especially the passive immunity comes only through the maternal colostrum as well as from the maternal milk containing the IgG. Whereas nowadays the people are stopping the lactation to the children before 6 months. I used to say in a meeting, my father told me when I was studying in the college that he used to take the milk from his mother until he is third standard. So he will enter school and he will come back and he will take the milk. So for 6 years, those children in the periods before 70s, 80 years were taking the lactation. But now, within 6 months, they are closing up the lactation, and that is one of the factors for the breast cancers. So the lactation stopping is also one of the factors for the breast cancer patients in women. Next one is aerobic exercise. So minimum half an hour aerobic exercise is very much essential to prevent the cancer. It may be walking increases your HDL, already you know that. And beyond walking, you can do some indoor exercises also. So if the exercise is not done, that will also result in obesity. Obesity will lead to cancer and the other complications. And the acquired immune deficiency, everybody knows that how the HIV comes, means the immune deficiency becomes lower, your TH cells will be completely barrack. So acquired immune deficiency is also another reason for the cancers, suppose the sarcoma. Then omega 3 fatty acids, that is very important. What is the subtle difference between N6 omega fatty acids and N3 omega fatty acids? These omega 3 fatty acids are very much rich in fish feed or fish meat as well as in the flax seeds. So when you are a vegetarian, the only alternative to the omega 3 is only the flax seeds. So they are the good alternative to the fish. So I always talk that per capita consumption of an Indian is only 2.5 to 3 kilo fishes per year, whereas a Japanese consume about 40 kilograms of fishes every year. That is why he is not having any complaints. The incidence of cancer is also very low among Japanese, but that is because of the omega 3 rich fish food. Then excess of chlorine, this is also very good observation in by my students. So when the chlorine in the form of hypochlorite, when dissolved, the fishes showed the symptoms of hyperkeratinosis, hyperplasia of cells in the brain. They have noticed the gliosis, all these things. So what is the impact of chlorine? We know that when the chlorine is converted into monochloramine or dichloramine, it will become a cancer carcinogen. Likewise, the nitrate. So you know, you would have heard of the blue baby. So the nitrate, when they are metabolized and converted into nitrosamine, that becomes a carcinogen in the stomach of the colorectal regions. Then non-vegetarian foods in excess. In our survey, 300 people we surveyed, the cancer patients. Out of them, 260 people were non-vegetarians. And only 60 people are vegetarians. So the more the non-vegetarian food they take, more the probabilities of cancer origin is there. So I have distinguished what are all the exogenous factors and the endogenous factors. So in fact, the facts very important. I said that what is the difference between omega 6 or the N6 fatty acids and N3 fatty acids. My students have analyzed through GS, that is gas liquid chromatography, the ratios between different essential fatty acids. So invariably in all cancer tissues like the colon, rectum, intestine, then in the breast, then in the uterine tissue, as well as in the cervix, the two essential fatty acids, N6 fatty acids, one is a palmitic acid, another one is a linoleic acid. Both are essential only, but their excess will cause cancer. And in the same tissues, the linoleic is zero. Then in the same tissue, the short-chain fatty acid, butyric acid, the one is the origin means butter. From the butter we get butyric acid, that butyric acid is completely absent. So these are the indicators for the pronouncement of cancer or for the probability of cancer origin. Suppose if biopsy is done, definitely I say that the cholesterol will be more and the palmitic acid will be more, then the linoleic acid will be more, there won't be any butyric acid, and uric acid is more higher. So that is the only exception I found out. Uric acid kills the cancer cells, but how come that the uric acid is present in the cancer cells in high amount? And when I referred to the literature, I got out one point, that is uric acid helps the chemotherapy. Suppose if the imatinib is given or the any other cancer drug is given, uric acid is augmenting the cytotoxic effect of the chemotherapeutic drug. So that way, uric acid is ambiguous with regard to the probability of cancer cells. So these are the general attributes I have taken from cancer literature, where we know that uncontrolled condition, autonomous growth, heritability and transplantability, altered cell surface, dedifferentiation, loss of specialized functions, stem cells differentiation. So that is one important. So what is the difference between a normal cell and a stem cell? So if a tissue has got stem cells, cancer also has got stem cells. How much proportion of stem cells are present in a tumor mass? About 0.8 to 1%. From 0.8 to 1% cells of the total tumor mass is resistant stem cells. They have got different antigenic expression. They will be resistant to your radiation. They will be resistant to your chemotherapy. And these are the residual stem cells which you repopulate in the primary site. As a result, your cancer would be revived. So that is one big problem to tackle by chemotherapy. Then the last one is the invasiveness and metastasis. This is a journey from when once a cell is transformed to take up the different profiles. It gets a latent period of about 15 to 20 years. So the cancer will not come all on a sudden. It takes about 15 to 20 years. That is why the accumulation of 1 lakh mutations given by in one report by the farmer is justified. So at what time, at what number they will be expressing the cancer manifestation, we don't know. This is again another cardinal characteristics or hallmarks of cancer. Recently in 2011 given by Hanagan and Greenberg, self-sufficiency in the growth signals, insensitivity to anti-group signals, evasion of apoptosis. You know the apoptosis is now thrown off very elaborately in all research meetings, because apoptosis is a programmed cell death. Already it was there in our normal tissues. Even your renewal of the blood system is based on the apoptosis only, programmed cell death. But only after the discovery of the apoptosis phenomenon in xenoarthritis elegans by Sidney Brenner, and how much this apoptosis can be applied to control the cancer cell growth has become prominent. And limitless replicative potential, then sustained angiogenesis. Still, we are facing problems to arrest the angiogenesis process in Canada. One particular research, everybody knows that the cancer can come to all tissues, to all organs, to all cells, but not the cartilage cells. So the cartilage is inhibiting to the cancer cells growth. So they are involved in research how these cartilage chondrocyte cells are preventing this angiogenesis phenomenon, neoangiogenesis, which is very vital for the intravascularization of the cancer cells to get into the blood channel or into the lymphatic ducts. Then the next one is a tissue invasion and metastasis. I have written one paper how this primary metastatic cells will immunocompromise with the distant organ. It is just like a transplantation only.
So whenever a different organic goes and settles, before that it should make a compromise. That compromise is made by different mechanisms. So that way the tissue invasion and metastasis is also very important to control in the cancer disease. Now I come to this nutrition chapter. So number one, I want to emphasize whether the dieting, whether the dieting is essential for the patients or the dieting is essential also for the cancer cells. 2 points are of interest. So we need to dietize the patient also, and we also need to restrict the diet supply to the cancer cells. Already I have given the reason how the glucose uptake will be detrimental to the patient, but it will be augmenting or enhancing the growth of the cancers, and how this lactic acid becomes a microenvironmental niche. All these things I have apprised. So even in a canal therapeutic drug, they cannot be able to contain all these things. The microenvironmental niche of lactic acid cannot be contained. The growth of the proliferation of the unlimited growth of the cancer cells are not stopped by drugs, because the continuous supply of glucose makes it to continue in spite of the 80% of death by cytotoxic drugs. Already we know that chemotherapeutic drugs are plenty. So more than 3,000 drugs are available, generic drugs are available in the form of anti-metabolites or alkaloids or alkylating agents or cisplatins or as monoclonal antibody trastuzumab, all these things. But in spite of that, how come these chemotherapeutic drugs are not working? In one paper I have written whether the chemotherapeutic drugs are they are called magic bullets or tragic bullets. So once you see the effect of the side effects of the chemotherapy, you will agree with me that it is not a magic bullet. Instead, it is only a tragic bullet. But the real real magic bullet is in the nearby. So we have arrived at. It is a magic bullet is a term given by Paul Ehrlich, the famous immunologist. He was telling that we are not lost in the boundless sea. We will see one day in biology and medicine the magic bullets. So even one lecture, the farmer has apprised that he has produced one chemotherapeutic drug. When it is applied, it will go and bombard the cancer cells, and the balloon is bursting. Immediately the audience are clapping. It is not so. So once you employ a drug, the cancer cells initially they may die, but they may have some other mechanisms. They have got the umpteen number of pathways to survive. So the anti-apoptotic mechanisms is operating all the time in the cancer cells. So in that way, the flavonoids are very important. I have got some students worked in different plants. For example, in Tamil, the Nayuridin, in Akiratus Aspira, and also in the Kata Amanakinore herb. All these plants are noted for the flavonoids content. The flavonoids are good regulators of glucose. So they are very very much sought for the diabetic patients. Then likewise, the lignans. So they can prevent the prostate and the colon cancers. I said the lignans are of the constituent of the mushrooms. Butter mushrooms as well as the leaf mushrooms present on the angiosperm trees are very much now a remedy to cancer, to prevent as well as for the cure. Because mushrooms, I will give you what are the reasons why these mushrooms are now become a table menu, daily table menu in our food. Then next one, phenols, polyphenols and tannins. So I want to mention one thing here. The phenols, when they get into the immune system, they become complex with the glucose and they become polyphenols. The polyphenols are not only what is called acting against the free radicals formation. Sometimes they will also bind with the extracellular proteins. I mean that here, whenever a tumor growth is happening, it's the growth, the tumor mass surrounded by an extracellular matrix. This extracellular matrix is provided with four important proteins. I think laminin, nectin, then what is called collagen. All these things are very much important. But the cancer cells produce on the outside not only antigens but also the proteases. And these proteases are collectively called the matrix metalloproteinases. they will completely clear away these important extracellular matrix proteins, and they can able to help walk and enter into the neoangiogenesis vessels. So that is why it becomes uncontrollable. Whereas if you take a polyphenol continuously, the polyphenols have got multi ligands, and these multi ligands will bind with every protein they come across. As I said, when your proteins are tightly linked, are tightly bound with polyphenols, the cancer cells cannot able to escape, cannot able to enter. Intravascularization is not possible. One of my students, Dr. Borwal in Malaysia, he did wonderful work with beta carotene. So he worked in cerebral aneurysm. So cerebral aneurysm, the blood vessels become thinned out. As a result, anytime it will burst. So he took the root mice, that is, thymus removed root mice, and he started feeding the beta carotene directly to these mice, and he found that the spleen weight increased and the thickening of the blood vessels in the brain happened. He has observed this one, and this becomes a beautiful observation which we can apply to neoangiogenesis, against the neoangiogenesis process of the cancer cells of the tumor. Next one is the phytosterols. All the organs contain the phytosterols. Now we are going again back to check the N9. So what we discouraged after the entry of your sunflower, safflower, all these things, we now go back to the check N9. So before 60 years only, the check N9 will come out, but not in the banner. Just like that, they will come in cattle cars, and they will give it to houses. But now it has become a big propaganda. So not to check the N9, not check the N9, like that. So next one is the pharynx, genistrins and phenols. And one thing I have missed, that is the saponins. In all the herbal studies of my students, there are noticed saponins presence. So it is nothing but the soap, glycerin sulfate. So even in my book I have written, so the simple thing, whenever you wash your hands with the soap, all the viruses will break down. So one paranatra has observed that when the glycerin sulfate is applied to the viruses, it capsid protein has become torn off, and even the nuclear core is torn off, and that is the beautiful observation. So the simple thing, that is, every time before going for meals or any food items, when we wash the hands, the plethora of viral infections will be averted. So the difference between omega 6 and omega 3, already I have said, they are omega 6 is an inhibition of aromatase pathway or using arachidonic acid, whereas the omega 3 to contrary. And likewise, the cyclooxygenase 2 activity will promote the prostaglandin synthesis, that is induced by omega 6 polyunsaturated fatty acids, whereas your omega 3 fish oil will inhibit the cyclooxygenase activity. And so many compounds like curcumin, galangin from ginger, then pepperin from pepper, and some other natural compounds, even your tamar pandit. So last week I went to Taj Coromandel party. They served on vatal. That is nothing but tamar pandit.
Lotus stem.
I thought lotus stem, why they are keeping instead of apalamandal. Then I thought that this is the rare occasion we will get only here, this lotus stem or the pedantle of the flower. So I have taken the whole thing. So like that, so many, because it is very rich. One of my students now submitted a thesis where she worked in Nilambiyam, I think so, in Lucifera. Species name is Tamare, Ventamare or Sendamare. So in that she has worked, and she has proved that they contain the quercetin. The quercetin is responsible for giving immunity as well as preventing certain disease aspects. So the what are the omega 3 PFA already I have given, how this acts against the tumor growth or the metastasis. Then mushrooms are very important, because immediately after entering into this room, I asked Dr. Kabinan, you have become lean. And he said, I am not taking fast food at all, I am restricting my calories. So that is most advisable one to the patients also. Otherwise they will go on like a gluten. They will go on eating food, whatever they see, whether it is outside or it is, whether it is polluted or unpolluted, they will go on taking the menu. So they are like low calorie food, they are completely fat free, then they have got high fiber content.
All of these are antagonistic to cancer growth. So, they are enriched with minerals. I mentioned that selenium. So, in America, aged people developed the prostate cancer because they have lacked the selenium. When their plasma was tested, the selenium content was very low. So, when the aged people contains low selenium content in the plasma, definitely they are prone to get the, whether the BPH or the cancer of the prostate. Then it is also rich in vitamins, the following vitamins I have mentioned, and Japanese scientists have revealed how they have become an immune booster
and how they fight infections and cancer and how the immune, they also cure the autoimmune diseases, especially the systemic lupus erythematosus, and how its glutamic content is antimicrobial, and how it excretes the cholesterol and lowers the cholesterol, lowers the BP, and it is preventing the heart problem and other diseases. 3-year mushrooms in China is a diet to inhibit the blood clotting problems, which is very characteristic of cancer patients.
And selenium in the mushrooms
prevent all cell damage when it is given along with EVM, vitamin E. And in Baltimore, that I have mentioned, 80 persons lacking the blood selenium are prone to suffer prostate cancer. The white mushroom, Agaricus bisporus, promotes the estrogen synthesis in the postmenopausal women. So that they advise that a woman should take at least one pearl mushroom daily. The phytochemical lentinum in mushroom increases the immunity by stimulating the T cells, macrophages and NK cells. So this part is very important because the chemotherapy suppresses all these cell activities, normal cells activities. And so when you take mushrooms in your diet, definitely the natural or the active acquired immunity becomes enhanced. In Japan, purified lentinum is given to cancer patients alongside chemotherapy. I would like to read one particular Gainer is a nutrition specialist.
He has a question as well as given the answer.
What happens to your body if you eat enough broccoli trees, cabbage bunches, carrots, tomatoes, soya foods, fish oils, onions, apples, garlic, mushrooms, ginseng, vitamins, minerals, cereals, grasses, cups of green tea, and a few dozen other things? Answer. Your body politely will say thank you and begins to live at a far higher level of health and energy than most of the other bodies around you. So, what we think and what we eat combined with your will make what we are physically and we are mentally. And Hippocrates also already mentioned, let food be your medicine and not medicine be your food. So, eating all these cause nothing but benefits, cause no loss but gains, cause no loss of life but survival, and survival is very much paramount for cancer patients. So phytotherapy is going to be the state of our therapy in future, in the nearby future, and it is going to be a new wave and new horizon in cancer therapy. The doctor of the future will give no medicine, but will interest his patients in the care of human frame, in diet, and in the cause and prevention of the disease. It is given by Thomas Alva Edison for 400 years. So thank you.